Hey guys, hi and welcome once again to another episode of Weekly Showcase. Today I have with me Rajat, who has been a winner and a runner-up in two of our challenges on WhatsApp. But today we're going to talk about the one we did on digital well-being and WhatsApp. Very interesting and unique problem statement. It is pretty much the only challenge that we've done, whereby we are asking how the use of a product can be reduced so that you feel better in a way, because we know how addictive WhatsApp is. And obviously that has certain repercussions in our life. Before we get into that, I'd like to introduce you to Rajat. Good afternoon, Rajat. Sorry, messing up with the time. How are you?
Pretty good, given the pandemic situation.
Yeah. Oh, relatively very good. Okay, fair enough. Where are you right now? Where are you based?
I'm based out of Bangalore and I'm currently in my home.
Okay, and you are a student, right? Correct?
Yeah, finally a master's in design student.
Master's in design, interesting. And what is this course about? I'm aware of the course. If you could just let the audience know what you...
So we have something called design-led innovation. Something similar to strategic design that's offered in other courses. We call it design-led innovation. Not just human-centered design as such, but looking at systems, looking from a system perspective and, you know, try to make sense out of it. That slightly unconventional, but it's working for us.
It's working for you. And you're based, so this is your final year? What is this, like a 3-year course?
I'm in my final semester for now. Okay. So I'll be starting my capstone starting Jan first week.
And some good news also, you recently got a job offer also from?
Adobe India.
Adobe. Congratulations. Yeah. It's a happy moment for us as well. Once our community member gets any kind of a placement, and it's your first job in design. Anyway, we'll come to that some other day. We'll have a conversation on that experience. But today we are going to talk about this challenge on WhatsApp. And before we get into what Rajat presented, I'd love to show the audience here what the challenge was about. So this is about, you know, adapting a product, you know, changing the product in certain ways so that, you know, you don't feel that... especially in the current time, you know, it's not an easy problem statement. What are the changes that you make so that for a particular segment? And here we are talking about the age segment that we were talking about was the elder people, like our parents or grandparents. That was the segment that we were targeting. And, you know, we wanted to ensure that the product is created in a way that it does not interrupt your life or does not take over your life. We are seeing that a lot with operating systems, as well as even somewhere YouTube, etc. They give you, you know, what stats, Instagram, all of them do that. But we felt those were just, you know, kind of touches, you know, those don't really affect in terms of how your usage changes, and not enough is being done is what we felt. But we wanted to tackle one of the biggest products and most used products in India, which is WhatsApp. We didn't expect too many answers to come out of this, to be very frank, because it's not an easy problem. It's not a problem that is, it's a silent problem is what I had stated, right? It's not a problem that most people even realize. So we are not expecting a solution, but we were expecting at least an approach towards a solution. And I think Rajat kind of hit the bullseye. Rajat, Nupur. Nupur was the winner, Rajat the runner-up. And Rajat, so I'll get you in here. And I think there are three parts to this. And this was the most important part for me, which set you apart from the others. Walk me through this. What do you mean by addiction versus overuse?
So technically, I mean, like generally we have this, right? Like whenever we use something a lot, we call it an addiction. Yeah. But if you look at the definition of it, addiction has a very different meaning. It has a substance abuse and like maybe, yeah, the effects of it, the want of it, like you go back to that platform to get the dopamine hit, fair enough. Just because you have that, there's a pattern to it, doesn't mean it can be called as addiction. It's more of an overuse. That's something I wanted to base this research on.
Very interesting.
I mean, like, technically, yeah, even we like doing, if we like doing our jobs, like we keep on doing it, doesn't mean we are addicted to it.
Leads to burnout in people. Yeah.
Exactly. We are passionate about it. So somewhere, if you get the terms right, it helps us in the solution.
If you approach somebody who's got a problem and they know, I mean, most people who use WhatsApp a lot, they already kind of know that they're doing it, and you tell them that you are addicted to it, I don't think that's going to create a positive impact. I think that's actually going to make them feel worse. That's my understanding of it. And I think you kind of captured that part well. Overuse is the right term and not addiction. Fair enough. Then you brought in a model, which I remember very distinctly from a TED or TEDx, really, I don't remember which one. But please walk me through this and why you chose this model. What was the reason for picking this up? Because you're the only one. Again, nobody else kind of thought about this kind of a model to approach this problem.
So this is a framework by Adam Anter, same thing, even I got to know from a TED talk of his. I mean, the way he, so fair enough, like if someone is spending, you know, 6 to 7 hours in a day on his smartphone, it is a problem. But how do you show it is something even I was trying to find out. Yeah. And this framework, the moment you visualize the data, it makes a lot more sense. And that's something he did. Like even the data was like 15, 20 minutes and he kept engaging. Like, you know what's happening here 24 hours. But the moment you put it in the framework, everything seems visual and like people will be like, oh, okay, this is where I'm spending my smartphone usage.
We'll come to one example from what you've said, and maybe you can run us through that. But one interesting thing, this is an older video, right? This is a 2017, was the last time when it was done. And there was no pandemic then. I can hardly imagine what this is going to look like today. If somebody does this kind of a study now, it's going to be pretty scary. Because, I mean, work is happening via a screen. Entertainment is happening there. Sports is happening there. Everything is happening there. I don't know. And we actually don't know how humans will react to that, especially youngsters. I mean, we took one end of the spectrum, which is the older people, because they are unguided and, you know, they don't have anybody. It's very difficult to tell your parents, right? You know, you are using your phone too much when you yourself are using it, maybe for work or whatever. It's very, very difficult. Mm. Fair enough. And I think what you did well, not just the model, I mean, you can suggest the model and framework, but you applied it very, very nicely to the participants that you chose. Run me through this. Like, what are you trying to show in this visualization of the time span?
So if you look at the 24, I mean, like, this is something I based it on a present scenario. And that's limited only to one particular device. So technically, we'll be having 2 to 3 devices. But somewhere, I had to focus it on one device, and that's where the smartphone came in. If you look at it, this is a participant of like I spoke to.
Okay.
10 hours of it goes to sleep, fairly as well. So they need that rest. 3 hours of basic work needs, and 4 hours of you know, preparing for health, diet, walking, and all those stuff.
This is still a very relatively healthy and well thought of person. I mean, this is still relatively good. Yeah.
The leisure time is something that he stressed on creating the habits. Even the digital well-being apps that we have, they don't do nothing more than, you know, just visualizing. Okay, this is the screen time that you have.
Yes.
Nothing apart.
Yes. Yes.
Somewhere they don't create habits or they don't help you in creating habits.
Yeah.
In a real world, in an ideal world, at least, that's something he stresses on, saying, okay, that personal space is meant to be for your you know, creating a habit or something. Correct. that's kind of an upskilling kind of a thing.
Correct.
That's something can be done. That's a productive thing. So that's something he wanted to stress on. Then, I went to a meta level and started collecting the data on, like, okay, where all the smartphone is coming and where all the WhatsApp is coming. Because of most of the time, you know, like the news or the recipes or like whatever the things happen through WhatsApp, and they need that. So it happens from there. And like, if I put it everything together, that's what the framework came in. And like somewhere I could suggest that, okay, saying now that your WhatsApp use is coming in that sleep space, you can reduce it, and you can use it in somewhere else. Or, you know, you can try to limit it. That's how you can control your digital, I mean, I don't know if we can design apps around it, but at least the awareness can be a good start.
Awareness, that's the term. I mean, the awareness, the minute you have an awareness that, you know, how much you're eating into the other parts of your life that you were doing, I guess then, because you can, there's a saying, right? You can get the horse to the lake. You cannot make the horse drink the water, right? You can get it through the pond, not the lake. I guess this is something like that. You can kind of create nudges and, you know, adapt. That's why we said adapt. You cannot change and overhaul, because it is an intrinsic part of our day-to-day life now, WhatsApp. It's very difficult to dissociate, because especially when you are trying to be in contact with other people, you are trying to run your business. Some of the participants you interview, they're running their business also of WhatsApp. So interesting. From that, I would like to come to more about, you know, what your experience has been, what are you planning to do in life in future also. And more importantly, how did you discover us? Because I remember the first challenge we did in Weekly, you were a winner of that challenge. And that was an even more difficult topic, and which is a topic which is even rife now, which is fake news. How did you, like, is it an interest? Because I remember once I was conversing with you, and you said you were interested in activism also to some extent. Privacy laws, all those things are very, very deeply. One of the few people that I've come across in the design research space in our community who has this grain in him, which is very unique and which is great to hear. Where did this come from? Where did that? And you're pretty young. It's not like you're somebody who's 30, 35 years old. That's when you kind of get in. So where did that come from?
I mean, like, at least with the introduction, I think I there was a collaboration between UX App and IDEA
Yes.
back in 2018 or 2019.
Very interesting. I saw you. You were a participant there. I went up and saw your profile. I said, my God, it's since then. It's been almost 2.5 years. Yes.
Yeah, but in between, yeah, I lost the touch. Somewhere, I didn't like the hackathons that I was participating in. Like, I was participating through my college days.
Yeah.
I didn't like it because, like, the sprint of it that we do, you know, we just do it for the sake of it. I didn't like the hackathon concept back then. But after some time, we were just doing the research pattern. Like, we were never arriving at the solution phase.
Correct.
Or even the ideation.
Correct.
Then I started in the hackathon space. And, yeah, given the pandemic, WhatsApp was the first thing. And at the same time, I was working on the, you know, like the fake news in general, I was understanding what it does.
Fantastic.
And it started from there. Yeah. I mean, like back then, as I said, it was more of a whiteboard challenge exercise for me, but now it's more of a learning. Like you learn from the business perspective. That's something we lack in colleges. Like the conversations that we have in WhatsApp groups or like even the articles that get shared.
Yeah.
These things help a lot, like in framing your research. In terms of my interest, I did my bachelor's in information security and Android applications.
Okay.
So two different specializations. One of these was coding, and I mean, like, I didn't like coding generally. So the other one was information security. Like, so we spoke a lot about how the data gets transferred, like what's the dark side of data and dark side of information security itself. So it was like, that was the conversation that kept us moving and, you know, learn more about it. I didn't take it as a career option, but it was a good conversation starter for me. Eventually in design, I took these things and started. We have something called line of inquiries. So you can take that one line of inquiry and you can base multiple classroom projects out of that. So I took data and privacy, and that's where most of my learning came from. And some of my faculty are like actively involved in these conversations. So I learned a lot from them. And that's how it started. Even now, I feel that designers can offer a lot in the privacy domain.
Yes,
it's a very niche thing,
but it's needed. But it's needed. You take a look at any of the top properties where people go to, you know, where the traffic goes, and privacy is the number one thing that is kind of concern. Like even the recent news around Facebook also is something related to privacy in some way, because you know, if one person, two or three people have all the data about everybody, it does become concern. And if designers get involved, then you really start having a true conversation, because product people are ingrained towards business. Designers are more humane is what I genuinely feel.
We get that human aspect, and somewhere at least, we might not contribute a lot, even in terms of policy making. So that's something I wanted to get into, but that requires a different skill set altogether. But at least I can be vocal on the human aspect.
Yes.
That's something, you know, I can contribute from my end, from a designer's end at least. And designers and ethics, that's something, you know, that can be a great combination going ahead. And like privacy seems to this nice field. And like now that slowly companies are changing, I thought, okay, maybe that should be one particular domain I should be targeting. Like being ethical would be a new business model for many people.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
That's great to hear from somebody so young. That's really great to hear from, because you need a lot of awareness about what's happening around you in the world. I mean, most of the time, most people are not aware. That's why they don't take it up. But great to see. And there, for the part that you mentioned, there is time for that. But now you are on a stepping stone to your first design job. All the best with that. Congratulations on that. Again, we'll have a conversation around that sometime later, because that, I think, is also a journey which other people would love to hear. How do you get into that kind of a role? But today has been fantastic. Thank you so much for taking your time out. And once again, all the best with your career. And you guys, in case you like this content, do subscribe. We'll have more such videos and conversations with our winners coming soon. Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.